Hey kids! So today we're going to be talking about a subject that, if you remember the first episode of the vlog, you know is very near and dear to my heart, gay rights, and specifically gay marriage. And the topic came up today because today is the Senate vote on HJR 6 in Iowa. And if you don't know what HJR 6 is, don't worry, because I'm here to tell you all about it today. So this will be an educational vlog, but it will also be fun. So to understand what's currently happening in Iowa, we need to know a little bit of the history of gay marriage in Iowa. So let's take our magical time machine back to 2009. Alright, so in 2009, there was a case that came before the Iowa Supreme Court called Varnum v. Bryan. And in this case, six same-sex couples filed suit claiming that defining marriage as between one man and one woman violated the Equal Protection Clause in the Iowa State Constitution. On April 3rd, 2009, the Iowa Supreme Court unanimously ruled that it was, in fact, unconstitutional. The court said that it was their job to protect the constitutional rights of individuals, quote, even when the rights have not yet been broadly accepted, end quote. The court said that the Iowa Constitution's Equal Protection Clause requires laws treat everyone who is similarly situated equally under the law. They said that gay couples were similarly situated to straight couples for purposes of Iowa's marriage laws, so both gay and straight couples needed to be treated equally under Iowa's marriage laws. So since the Iowa Supreme Court declared marriage between same-sex couples to be legal and constitutional in the state of Iowa, same-sex couples from across the country have been flocking to Iowa to get married. However, there is a potential wrench in the works coming down the road. In 2010's midterm elections, five of the Supreme Court justices who voted in favor of equal marriage rights were up for re-election, and three of them were not re-elected to their positions on the Iowa Supreme Court. This is the first time that a judge has not been reappointed since Iowa began allowing voting on judges in 1962. Republicans across the state took these results as a mandate from the public on the issue of same-sex marriage, and they began trumpeting, "The people have spoken," on any news outlet that would let them speak. So Republicans decided right away that they were going to run with this supposed mandate, and they brought HJR 6 in front of the Iowa House. HJR 6 stands for House Joint Resolution 6, and it's a joint resolution proposing an amendment to the Constitution of the state of Iowa. This amendment would read, "Marriage between one man and one woman shall be the only legal union valid or recognized in this state." It also calls for a referendum on the amendment. So instead of just inserting this amendment into the Constitution, the people of Iowa would vote on it. So basically this means that the citizens of Iowa would get to go to the ballot box and vote on the rights of other citizens of Iowa. It probably will not come up for vote until 2014, but there are ways that the issue could be pushed and get onto ballots sooner than that. HJR 6 passed the Iowa House on February 1st with a 62-37 vote, and according to schedule, it will come up for discussion and potential vote in the Senate of Iowa today, February 22nd. So, the answer to this comes in two parts. The first part is the religious aspect. There are, technically, a couple of Bible verses that talk about being gay being bad, specifically Leviticus 18:22 and Leviticus 20:13, but there are also several other behaviors that the Bible considers to be bad or sinful that people don't talk about as much. For example, having a tattoo is listed as bad in Leviticus 19:28. Eating shellfish is called bad in Leviticus 11:10. And Mark 10:11-12 speaks out very strongly against divorce, which is even more to the point since we're talking about marriage today. So unless people who want to ban gay marriage on the premise of, you know, it's against the Bible, it's against what God wants, you should also be banning tattoo parlors, anywhere that serves shellfish, and divorces. So unless you're willing to make an across-the-board sweeping ban of everything that the Bible says is bad, not just these, but many other things, clothing of mixed fibers, for example, you might want to be careful about saying that you want to ban gay marriage based on the Bible, because it tends to make you look like you're picking and choosing your Bible verses, like you're a little bit of a hypocrite. Speaking of looking a little bit like a hypocrite, the Bible mentions lots of things that you should or should not do, but Jesus was asked point blank at one point in the New Testament what the most important commandment was, and he said that there were two: to love your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and then to love your neighbor as yourself. And that's Mark 12:31 if you want to look that up. So if God is saying to you that the most important thing, well, one of the two most important, is to love your neighbor as yourself, I would tend to think that loving and accepting everyone for who they are would be more important than condemning homosexuals and saying that they're going to hell. But that's just me interpreting what God said was most important. There's also the political aspect of that question. For one thing, if you look back at America's history, freedom of religion is actually in the First Amendment of the Bill of Rights, so it's written into one of the founding documents of our country. So there's a pretty long-standing history of separation of church and state, and of religion not being a direct part of policy and politics. And, I mean, if you want to get super technical about why religion shouldn't influence our decisions, it's because America is a democracy, not a theocracy. We should probably stop trying to govern ourselves as a theocratic nation and be a democratic nation that bases our laws not on whatever the majority religion happens to be. So, is judicial activism really the issue here? To understand that, we have to get a pretty good definition of the judicial branch. Now, if you want to get technical, the Constitution doesn't actually mention anything about judicial review. But judicial review has been a long-standing tradition in America, going back over 200 years to 1803 with Marbury versus Madison. This case established that courts have the power to decide if something is constitutional and to strike down laws or behaviors that are found unconstitutional. The Iowa Supreme Court definitively found unequal marriage rights in the state of Iowa to be unconstitutional and ruled as such. They also have tremendous precedent, particularly in the case of Brown versus Board of Education from 1954. That case ruled that separate was not equal. In the case of marriage rights, separate is definitely not equal. There are 1,138 rights given to married couples, but denied to couples in civil unions under current laws. These rights include joint taxes and income tax deductions, hospital visitation, rights after death of spouse, including Social Security and survivor benefits, next of kin status, guarantees for alimony and prenuptial agreements, and several things having to do with estate taxes and property taxes, among many others. Civil unions are not only a way of keeping gay couples separate from straight couples by naming what they are allowed to be in something entirely different, they're also a way of keeping the two groups' rights totally unequal. This might seem like a ridiculous question to ask, and you might have laughed out loud when you read it. I know I sure did, but it's actually being asked. Iowa House Judiciary Committee Chairman Rich Anderson, a Republican from Clarinda, Iowa, said that the Equal Protection Clause of the Iowa Constitution only requires laws to treat those who are similarly situated equally. He says gay couples are not similarly situated to straight couples because gay couples can't reproduce on their own. Anderson says that marriage, from the state perspective, is, quote, not about love, not about romance, it's about driving state policy toward responsible procreation, end quote. So, if you will, ignore for a minute the fact that Rich Anderson has pretty much not only just said that gay couples shouldn't get married, but also ruled out elderly couples, infertile couples, and couples that just don't want to have kids. There's also the fact that we have more than enough people in the world right now. The most recent accurate population numbers come from 2008 and say there are 6.5 billion people worldwide. UNICEF estimates the number of orphans in the world today at 210 million. So why not adopt some of them and let them have homes instead of constantly creating more children? And as for the argument that some people make that gay couples are not as good of parents as straight couples, well, for one thing, I would recommend you go to the links below and click on the amazing speech by Zach Walls about being raised by two lesbian mothers. It makes the point far better than I could. But to quote an expert that I heard recently, Straight couples often have kids by accident, whereas gay couples have to work really hard to have kids, either through adoption or surrogacy. So they obviously very much want to have children if they are having them, which I think makes them pretty fit parents. Because come back to me when your question isn't stupid. So, while I like to think that everyone cares about gay marriage and gay rights on a, you know, emotional, human, personal basis, this isn't the case. People have very busy lives, and for a lot of people, if something doesn't affect them personally, they just don't care, because they don't have the time to. So, how does gay marriage and the fight for gay rights affect you personally? Here's the way I see it. The argument that we saw come up earlier about polygamous marriages and interspecies marriages comes up a lot in gay marriage debates, and it actually comes up enough that there's a name for it. It's called the slippery slope argument. Here's how I see it. The slippery slope that we're talking about isn't one of who or what will be allowed to get married next. It's who's going to lose their rights next. If we allow HJR 6 to pass in Iowa, Iowa citizens will be voting on whether or not other Iowa citizens can get married. Citizens will be voting on the rights of other citizens. Now, when you look at it that way, it's a little bit terrifying. I mean, who's to say who will be next? It sounds ridiculous, yeah, to say that, you know, there's going to be a vote on interracial couples being allowed to be married or elderly couples being allowed to be married, but is it any more ridiculous or any more offensive than voting on whether or not gay couples can get married? If we start letting one group of people have their rights taken away, not just by the government, but also by a popular vote, who's to say what group will be next? So how does this affect you personally? Because if we let rights start getting taken away, that slippery slope could take us just about anywhere. I'm going to leave you today with a poem that pretty much sums up what I was just talking about, by a brilliant German scholar. First they came for the communists, and I didn't speak out because I was not a communist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there is no one left to speak out for me.
Forget the world now, we won't let them see. But there's one thing left to do. Now that the weight has lifted, love has surely shifted my way. Maybe.